Have you heard about Perplexity AI? It's an AI-based search engine, but it's got some major advantages over regular AI tools. It cites its sources, it can access the web in real time, and it has no ads at all. It's a legitimate replacement for Google most of the time, especially if you want an overview of a bigger result. But the fun part for me is that now it has a programmatic API. And better yet, it's a simple variation on the one from OpenAI. Let's see how easy it is to access it at a tiny fraction of the regular cost. Welcome to Tales from the Jar Side. Hi, my name is Ken Cousin, and on Tales from the Jar Side, I try to give you expert advice on coding in Java, Kotlin, Groovy, the Spring Framework, AI, and related topics. In this video, we're going to have a look at the new RESTful web service provided by the Perplexity API. Now, this is the Perplexity website, the regular site itself. And you see, it looks like a regular search engine, but let me show you what sort of answers you can get out of this. When you put in a topic, it will search the web in real time like a regular search engine, but it summarizes the results and it gives you the immediate sources that it used to find those results. So you could see all the information and with little footnotes on there to indicate where it got all of this. And that's very helpful. It can also give you follow-up questions and search images or videos or more. And of course, the biggest thing for most of us is that there's no ads on there anywhere. Now, Perplexity is located at perplexity.ai, which means it's yet another one of those web services that's registered at the tiny island in the Caribbean of Anguilla, however you pronounce that, whose country code, of course, its top-level domain is AI. So it's another one of those tech companies that registered their domain at that point just so they could end in .ai. This would all be well and good. This is fine, but what I want to focus on is the site called docs.perplexity.ai, which is their brand new API, their programmatic interface. So they have a little getting started page here, and let me just walk through it really quickly because they've got a quick start and it's not going to take us long to go through it. So in the quick start, they start off by telling you, yeah, you got to register and put in a key, but first things first, you got to give them a credit card. Not a big surprise. We'll talk about the costs in a couple of minutes. But the idea is it's still pay as you go, like all the other AI tools. Everything is charged per request, and unless you do an awful lot of requests, this is going to be way less expensive than interacting with the site directly. So once you've put in your payment and everything, the next step is to generate an API key, as they're showing here. So you make a key, you save it as an environment variable, and that way you can access it in the API itself. Now, what I want to go down here and show you is a little script they have, a demo script that they wrote in Python. Now, it's a little hard to see it here, so let me show it to you in my IDE. This IDE is PyCharm from IntelliJ. I have the IntelliJ tool suite set of products. So I'm using it here so I can use a nice big font with some syntax highlighting. And here's the best part. They are using the OpenAI library. So the same library that the OpenAI people provide automatically can be used for Perplexity. So they bring in the one class they need. I'm using the OS library in Python to retrieve my API key. And then here you see the low-level coding you write to provide the messages. They suggested a system message that says you are an artificial intelligence assistant and you need to engage in helpful, detailed, polite conversation with the user. And then here's the user message that says how many stars are in the universe. Okay. Down here, you'll notice they instantiate that OpenAI function, or they call it, with their own API key, the one from Perplexity. And they specify the base URL to go to api.perplexity.ai rather than the one that would go to OpenAI. That means that when they call create, they will look for that API key and go ahead and invoke the service. But you do also have to give it a model. Now, we'll look in a minute, at the available, what they call supported models. But here you can see it's based on Llama 3.1, and that's the Llama model, the open source one from Meta/Facebook. Once they do that, they just printed the response. So let me execute this and we'll take a look at the answer. So the output shows the full structure of the response. And again, this is the OpenAI API. We get a chat completion that has a collection of choices. And on the first choice at index 0, we have a completion message with the content, the number of the stars in the universe is a complex and challenging question to answer precisely, etc. You can see they have various estimates and they try to identify where some of these things came from and on and on. It's not too much, but you get something, you get an answer out of that. And it's not bad. So let's take a look at some of the issues that I said we were going to examine. First of all, the available supported models. The list of supported models is here. Let me magnify that a little bit. And you can see that they have these online models that are all based on Llama 3.1 of various parameter counts, 8 billion, 70 billion, and a whopping 405 billion parameters in their model. That one's a big one, and that one I wouldn't want to run on my machine myself. It would bring it to its knees no matter what RAM I have. So that one might be really interesting. Then they have their little chat models, but still based on Llama 3.1, and they do mention a couple of open source models as well. But all of them are based on the Llama 3.1, and they even give you a link to Meta's recommendations on how to do queries with Llama. The next thing I want to examine is the pricing model. Now, they're a little different on the pricing model than most AI tools, because here what they have is a fixed cost as well as the variable one. The fixed cost is $5 per 1,000 requests. So if you do the math, that's half a penny per request. So not a lot, but that's fixed no matter what you do. Then the variable cost has to do with the number of tokens that you put in the input and get back in the output. And once again, if you do the math, this works out to about half a penny per 1,000 tokens. And 1,000 tokens is a fairly good size. That's a lot. The one that they're suggesting is barely in the double digits, much less 1,000 tokens here. And you can get down to a tenth of a cent or even less if you use some of the smaller models. The chat models are pretty much the same. So there's the pricing model, not too bad. And in fact, it's pretty much the same as what you'll find on the regular tools if you go to them directly. If you go to OpenAI or you go to Anthropic for Claude or you go to Google's Gemini, that's roughly the same cost they will give you. What I now want to show you is a Java test case where I used the LangChain4j system in order to set up this model, just leveraging OpenAI again. So let me go to that section here, and you can see I've set up Perplexity Small and Perplexity Large, both of those online models, using the OpenAI chat model class provided by LangChain4j. I have to adjust the key to put in the proper key for them and the base URL in both cases. Here's the model name. I put in all the constants. In this one that I'm going to run, I'm going to log the requests and responses so you can actually see the output. Now, going back to the test case here, I actually asked it, okay, wait a minute, what's the difference between those Sonar online models and the Perplexity chat models? Because the documentation's a little thin on that. So I'll just generate an answer, and you might have noticed the outputs of Perplexity, very similar to the others, come out in Markdown format. So I'm writing the results to a Markdown file so I could preview it. Let me execute this and we'll look at the output. So here is the Markdown file that I generated. What's the difference between the Perplexity Sonar online models and the chat models? And they say lies in their primary functionality, context handling, and usage scenarios. The online models are designed to provide real-time access to the internet and up-to-date information. And the question is, do the chat models do that too? And it doesn't really address that, so I don't really know. So I'm going with the online models because that is the big feature that I want, is that they are directly connected to the internet and I should get good information out of them. But I can't really tell what the difference is. The context handling, it's funny how they go to great lengths to put in a paragraph here when they both use exactly the same number of tokens in the context window. So I'm not sure why they make a big deal out of it, but it's the same size. They do point out that if you try to use system prompts, that the search subsystem of the online models don't pay attention to the system prompt, but you can still change the style or tone of language and have it answer in pirate speak or whatever, something like that. Also, the usage scenarios that the online models are best suited for applications requiring real-time data access and integration and dynamic information retrieval and factual grounding, whereas the chat models are suitable for chatbots, support systems, any other applications requiring multi-turn conversations and high-quality responsive instructions. I don't really know why they're different, but there's the idea. And the pricing's basically the same, so there's not much there. So at any rate, that was the first question. I also did go ahead and say, all right, how many stars are in there in the universe? Let's see what it comes up with over here. So the answer I got this time is, again, estimating the number of stars in the universe is a complex task, and different sources provide varying estimates. And you can see how they do have sources and estimates, and very interesting information. They all come up with roughly the same number, the 2 times 10 to the 23rd, roughly. I mean, that's a lot. What's the bottom line? What is the advantage of using Perplexity API over the other models directly? The big selling point is that you do get real-time information along with their summarization model. Now, can you have better chats and conversations than you can with the others? I don't really know about that. I'm a little skeptical. OpenAI supposedly can access the internet, and I have seen it do it, but I don't know that it's designed to do it every time. Claude still cannot, by the way. So it is nice to have something that is designed deliberately to do searches over the web and give you real-time information and summarize them. So I think that's very helpful. It's good to have that ability. Now, if you're interested in accessing the other models programmatically, then I have videos on the channel on doing that, and I have other videos planned to do that. So if you're interested in any of that, please subscribe to the Tales from the Jar Side channel, and I'll present some other videos that make that process easier as well. In the meantime, feel free to use this model and let me know what you think. I'd love to hear your results as well, and look forward to additional videos from Tales from the Jar Side. Thank you.